Hi, here's a quick video on looking at touching up the paintwork on a Landrover Discovery 1. So what you find on the doors is they will bubble up a little bit and corrode in typical places, like just under the seal on the windows. Occasionally a little bit around the wheel arches. This is not rust, this is just where the aluminium reacts with the air and the water. Forms a little white powder that you can see has come off and covered the tyre. Here I've taken it off, but before I did that it bubbles up the paint. Not as bad as rusting, but it does corrode.
So we start to remove the rust with a belt sander, a small one as you see here, air powered, and it's useful to have a hoover such as what I'm using here is an old Dyson cleaner, and sand off the old paintwork. And on this roof position it's rust that's the problem, just around the bottom corner of the Alpine window, quite a common thing on these quite old Discoveries now. The removal of the window is quite straightforward, so try and remove as much of the rust as possible. And if you want to see how to remove the Alpine window, or indeed the lower side window, see a couple of my other videos. And you might want to also replace the rubber at the same time, because often that splits.
As you may notice, a few holes start forming, which will need some filling later. So we'll continue removing as much rust as we can. You can see a lot of the spots that I've done already, a little bit at the bottom of the door. This one was quite bad, so had a good go at it. Quite a few holes that have opened up. The seal comes down to this lower edge, so a lot of this will be invisible anyhow. So providing we get a good seal between the rubber seal and the bodywork, this missing metal shouldn't be too much of a problem, but for an extra bit of security, I think I'll just put a little strip of aluminium sheet behind it, make sure I get some good amounts of paint underneath and behind. I was going to have some filler on these holes, stop the water going in. May just use polymer seal on that rather than body filler, because it's a bit more flexible, more tacky, and should hopefully last longer. And a few of the other typical places on the doors. And the next stage is to use some etch primer, which, because it's small air, I'm just going to brush on. Etch primer is basically an acid that bonds very well onto the metalwork. Being an acid, it cuts into the metal. And once we've done the etch primer, then we'll put some two-pack primer on top to give it a nice thick base. Alright, here is our etch primer we're going to use. Happens to be some white stuff that I already had. Give it a good shake and good stir with something clean. Useful to have top of a spray can to make a little pot to dip your brush in. Nice little small brush just to do the touch-up areas. If you find it's too thick and you want to thin it, then it has to have a special thinner, not just the ordinary paint thinner, nor even the two-pack thinner. This is special etch primer thinner. Liquid does actually make quite a good liquid for cleaning, particularly where you've got rust marks that drip down onto the paintwork, which I did have here. A little bit of that thinner actually takes a lot of it off and is a useful general purpose liquid. Clean it at the paintwork prior to any painting or spraying, so we'll do that. And applying the paint all over the metal area. You need at least two coats of this to make sure the metalwork is well covered. Densely, this stuff, because remember from using it in the past that it does normally dry quite thinly. See how it's drying virtually straight away. Certainly after probably an hour it should be fully dry. Make sure you do the inside as well.
Where you do want a lot of the thinner, the etch primer thinner, is in cleaning your brush and pots off afterwards, of course. Just use lots of raw thinner, lots of tissues.
Okay, we've done two coats of the etch primer onto all the different areas, and now we've got to do something about building up this edge of the rusted out metalwork. Now obviously welding
is going to be the strongest, but it's going to be the messiest, and all of this paint's going to be ruined. So what I'm going to do is put a bit of sheet aluminium, which I'm going to glue to the inside, both sections, using polymer sealant, which is the same sort of stuff that you use for car body sealing. So sort of stuff that you'll see on the inside of your doors. This strip of bead that is painted, long lasting. As you can see, this car's 18 years old. That sealant is as good as new. Very tacky and paintable, and also makes a great adhesive. So we're going to get a little sheet of thin aluminium, look on eBay or your local sheet metal supplier. Now we need about that thickness, I'd imagine. Should do it. Try and get a nice straight cut with a pair of these tin snips. Now we've got a bend, an edge onto it, so we need to find a straight edge. Quite thin, this aluminium. That's ideal for manipulating around the space that we've got. Having these bends, of course, gives the metal a little bit of strength as well. And then we'll see if that's going to fit. Now what we'll do next is, using our fingers, we'll apply lots of polymer sealant behind this rotten section. Little tiny holes like that, we'll just smear over it and fill it all out. Needs a little bit of metal on that one. In fact, that hole gets covered by the metal anyhow, so that's fine. So any MS polymer sealant should do the job. Keyword being polymer. Alright, so we'll push out the sealant onto my finger and then rub lots of it underneath, which was nice and thick. And now let's get lots of this sealant over onto this side. See, it's very, very tacky, and even though this is aluminium, which is probably not the easiest substance to glue onto, has no problem at all gluing onto it, as you can see. So tacky, of course, that anything you touch it will stick to. So let's get a nice continuous thick layer of the polymer sealant all over it. That should do nicely. Okay, now we just need to get that in position. It's about there, I think, should do. Give that a bit of a push on. See the sealant ooze out. Because one of the advantages to doing a glue solution is that you keep this top panel nice and thin compared to welding, because if you attempted to do a weld repair on here, then no doubt it would end up a lot thicker, because it would be very difficult to grind off the inside edge unless you take all the trim off, of course. All of a sudden the job's getting bigger and bigger. So now we'll just smooth the polymer sealant around. Make sure these edges are all getting nicely covered. And might as well do the inside of the bodywork around there, where it's a bit rusty as well. And so this can be painted, but really we want to keep the sealant just to the area where the rubber seal is going to cover. It's going to be difficult to get completely smooth, not like you can with sanding down primer. So I'm just going to both clean up my gloves first, and then we'll rub off any excess sealant. See how sticky this stuff is. Get a tissue and rub along here. Keep that nice and smooth. There we go. Starting to look like it's part of the bodywork. Now this polymer cylinder does actually stay somewhat flexible after it's set, so it's not like it's going to crack and separate from the metal, but it is actually quite hard as well though. So I think we're just about there now. With some layers of primer that we're going to put on that and a little bit of sanding, hopefully that will come smooth enough. Okay, same again, another piece of metal, check it fits, which it does quite nicely. That will do. Okay, push that on, give it a bit of squeeze, stop that seal from getting too far over. Also going to use some of the seam sealer polymer sealant to seal up around this area of the door on the rear that is always going rusty. Rust is getting in both from the top and from the bottom. Use a lot of waxy oily underseal to seal it from underneath, and I've painted it and filled with it before in the past, but it's come through again. Since I've got the polymer sealant out, I'm just going to use this as a filler sealer. It's a reasonably hidden area of the bodywork and on a joint anywhere where you might expect to visibly see some seam sealer anyhow. Okay, now it's dried a little bit, probably half an hour. I'll keep my glove on. Apply a lot of saliva to the finger. And just do a little bit of flattening down. Good enough with a bit of primer and a bit of paint. Right, here we have some nice two-pack primer. It says mix 4-to-1 partner. So we only need a little bit, but I don't think the ratio is going to be fantastically important for a brush-on application. Except for the fact, I suppose, the more hardener you add, the quicker it's going to go off. It's a little bit old, so it's a little bit settled, so we'll give it a good stir. Mix it up, and then we'll get on with the painting. Okay, this is nice and thick stuff, this lot. Quite handy that it's a different colour as well. Because when we're sanding it down later, it's got a smoother finish. And as soon as we start going too far, you'll be able to tell because the white primer will start showing through. Right, the next job after the couple of coats of primer is to sand it down to get a nice flat surface. Started off quite a coarse sanding paper, and with a sander such as this, a little vibrating shoe sort. You can do it by hand. You could probably use the larger rectangular orbital sanders. This one, having a smaller head, is slightly easier to work into the corners. So you really want to wear a mask for doing this. And I quite like the gas masks that you can get secondhand. Stop the dust from getting over the wheels, probably quite a good idea. So and just gently work it round. As soon as you start to see the white of the primer underneath, where it was on top of the original paint, obviously it's going to stand a little bit more proud. So you just need to sand it back until it has a consistent colour all over. There we go, pretty consistent grey colour all over. Taking it down so that it's flat on the edges. Best way to feel how flat it is to go over it with your fingers, even through these gloves being quite thin. And then I need to go for a finer grade of sandpaper, just to go over this and remove the coarse marks from the coarse sandpaper I've used. So the idea here is just to try and respray the small areas rather than having to respray the whole wing. And hopefully what we'll do is have the join between the new paint and the old paint on the edge here. Try and taper in the new paint and have some overspray of the lacquer over the top, which we can sand down and polish to try and merge it into the old paintwork so you don't see the join. Alright, here we do the final bit of sanding with a finer grade. This happens to be a sanding block, one of these foam blocks covered in sandpaper. And what you're trying to do is remove any high or low marks which you can often feel by your finger, and also by looking for changes in colour of the surface, as some of it would be scratched and some where the paint is a little bit lower will obviously not be scratched by the sandpaper, so it tends to show up after you've sanded it. So here we are after a couple of coats, maybe two or three coats of the two-pack primer, undiluted, apart from mixing it with a hardener. And you can see this section where we originally had some holes is now filled quite nicely. Underneath was the polymer sealant slash seam sealer, and a few coats, maybe two or three, on the low spot areas of the thick primer. And it's just about level on this edge. This edge, of course, you won't see because it's underneath the windowsill. Most of it on the top of this edge you probably won't see anyhow, because cars at this height, unless you're well over 6 foot, you know, great difficulty seeing the recessed bit of this top edge. The only bit you're really going to see is the bit on the curved outer edge, and I think that's going to be good enough. So what we're going to do next is, rather than going for the final colour top coat, which I talked about earlier, it's pretty obvious feeling some of these, but we've got different hardnesses of the primer showing through. The original etch primer seems to be of a harder primer than the grey primer, which gives a slight little bit of unevenness to it. And also it's difficult to taper in against the original paintwork as well. So what I'm going to do next is use some two-pack gloss paint to go over these whole sections. Reason gloss is it'll show up any surface imperfections and bumps, so you can just look at it sideways and see if it's flat or not, because you'll be able to see the reflection changes as you look over it. And next reason is that also makes quite a good undercoat for the final colour. You see, the final colour is a very dark colour, so you won't need quite so much of the paint from the spray can containing the Epsom green. I don't have a huge amount of it anyhow. In terms of waterproofing the whole lot's going to be covered in two-pack clear lacquer. And we can have as many coats as we want of that on the top. The two-pack black, as I say, will show up in the imperfections. Probably have to sand it down and respray a few times with the black. The black paint is dirt cheap. I've already got that in stock as well. Instantly we can see the imperfections and sand them down, spray it again. And by going for a little wider area with the black, I'm hoping that I'll be able to taper the black gradually into the original paintwork as well. Don't really want to go past this edge, because it then starts to become very noticeable, because it's very difficult to match in metallic paint. So I think there's always going to be a little difference between the new and old metallic paint. Right, this is what we need next, some 2K gloss black, gravity fed spray gun, ideally gravity fed. A little measuring something or other, beaker. This happens to be the top of a spray can. Fast thinner and 2K fast hardener. I've used this as a mixing pot to measure how much paint you're mixing up. might be able to mix it and measure it in the same pot, or measure it in that and mix it in that. And you also want a preferably a fine filter to filter the paint before you put it into the spray gun. So here we see we've masked off the areas where we want to limit the spray to. Odd little spots of cosmetic corrosion around the car. Quite a lot of masking, because you don't want the spray going everywhere. So now to get on with the spraying.
So here we go with the black spraying.
Okay, there we can see where we sprayed it in the black, and just as well we're using the cheaper black paint rather than the more expensive top coat. Does very much show up the different levels of the paint. I don't know whether you can see it on this video, hopefully the light will catch it. You can see it shows the edge of where we've painted. Obviously where we've sanded it down, the primer is a little bit softer than the surrounding paint, giving you a little bit of a ridge around the edge. And so we can try and fill that with this black paint. Probably do a couple of coats and then leave it a day, come back and sand it the next day. The other little problem you might just see here is a couple, well, three little indentations. Not sure that comes out very well on the video, but trust me, basically these are impurities, a little bit of oil or water that's been sprayed out with the paint by the gun, despite having, where is it, despite having this moisture trap on the airline. It's obviously still getting either bits of condensation or possibly oil getting past that, so I'm going to fit an additional one onto the spray gun right at the head of the gun. So tiny little canister with a little filter in it, and fortunately the threads are the same as the threads on the gun. Don't think I tapered on this one. That's quite a bit stiffer. Stops in the air leaks coming out. There we go. The other thing that you need to work out is the direction of the airflow through this. So I did take it apart and have a look at how it's operating. Basically the air comes in here, comes out these tiny little holes inside the filter. So you want the input air to be going into the main part of the canister, and the output air goes through the goes through the filter before it goes into the gun. So any moisture or oil or anything should collect on the inside of this canister. Don't want to do it too tight because it's only plastic there. So hopefully that is a little bit better and we don't get any nasty imperfections coming out. So let's just see how that goes. Let's try on another spot. Now that was fine. No visible contamination spots. So carry on like that. So you've got a good two or three coats, leave it a day, sand it down, do some more till you get a smooth finish. The final gloss black finish, it's very similar in reflectivity to the final coat. She'll show you how flat that it's become. Once you're happy that it's flat enough, give it a final sanding with quite fine sandpaper, and then do the final top coat, and followed by the lacquer. Don't forget to wear a mask. I didn't just for that a little bit there, but I held my breath and stood back, and we're outside so it's well ventilated. So I quite like the gas masks, which is around somewhere. So one of these I got off eBay. I'd quite like to put some additional filters on the outside as well, but I haven't got at the moment. But the, obviously this is a big activated carbon canister, which is good for taking out the fumes. We're only doing little spots here, so the amount of exposure is quite low. Look after your health, because two-pack paint is very hazardous for your lungs. Apparently if you get heavily exposed to it, it can give you asthma, and a type of asthma that doesn't go away, you get it permanently. So something to be
aware of. So here we are after a few coats of the black spray, doing the final sanding down and checking for any imperfections. Basically keep sanding and spraying until you're happy with the final finish.
Okay, so I've given it a quick first coat of the top colour paint. A few imperfections have been showing up, so now I'm just sanding down this top coat with a bit of 1200 grade wet and dry paper, and then we'll give it another coat. Starting to appear smooth and imperfections are starting to disappear. Probably will require, well, will require another top coat of paint just to make sure that looks good, and then a very light sand before coating it in the lacquer. All right, starting to get there in terms of smoothness of the top coat. I've removed the tape, masking tape holding the paper to protect the bodywork. I've removed it because after a few days the tape starts going off and it will leave lots of gooey deposits. So I'll redo it with some more tape and more paper when I'm ready to do the top coat of lacquer. So not without quite a lot of problems of trying to get it flat and paint reacting with odd little bits of probably old wax despite cleaning it all off. Use panel degreaser to try and clean off the surface beforehand and for removing the residue from the tape. Not perfect finish, but good enough for my purposes. So I don't pretend to be an expert. More somebody who does it out of necessity to save a bit of money. I will just mention this is a section that's been done. You can either, well, if you sand off the top coat of coloured paint, you tend to get a little bit of a line where the paint has been. So what I tend to do is remove a lot of the masking and just give a very light coat of spray paint. So just a very light, see there's a bit of a line, if you can see that, yeah, is it the line where the masking tape has been and it's had a bit of sanding of the top coat. But I don't really want a line to be showing. So first of all, make sure it's clean, we haven't got any masking tape residue on there. Use our panel degreaser. I'm wet, wipe it off. See, we have a bit of a line that may show up as colour difference once the lacquer is applied. So what I'm going to do is just do a very thin coat, effectively tapering in the paint from old to new. Now when that's dried, should have more of a taper rather than a line, which is less noticeable to the eye. Right, we've got to the stage where we finished doing the final body colour paint, and just about to start spraying on the lacquer. So give it a final clean with the panel degreaser, just get a bit of dust off that's got onto it overnight. As you notice, I'm doing this outdoors on a nice still sunny day. It's not great having sun on your paintwork because of course the paint or lacquer is going to dry super fast, but a huge amount of choice here. I suppose I could turn it around before I spray it, try and find some shade, which is probably advisable. Now if you need to go over and sand a few little spots, like I have a little bit around here, you can see what it's going to look like after it's sprayed with lacquer just by quickly covering it with the degreaser. Now you can see there's a slight colour difference, so I think I'll go over that with a bit more of the body coloured paint. Now to spray with lacquer, obviously there's going to be some overspray of lacquer on the original paintwork, which I'm going to allow. I'm not going to mask it off because that will give me a ridge and a line on the join. Just having a little bit of overspray provides a smoother join between the new and the old paintwork. So just make sure the body is nice and clean and any old wax has been cleaned off. What we don't want is the lacquer reacting with any old wax that's still left on the bodywork. There's always a possibility. Sometimes you think you've cleaned it a lot and you end up getting a little reaction. So this is the other side around the window where we've got our repair to the rusted out sections. We've put our aluminium plate on there. We've joined it and filled it with polymer sealant, which is like a seam sealer. That should now at least be waterproof, at least when we put some sealer around the rubber, which we'll do when it's put on.
Okay, here I'm mixing up the lacquer coat. It's called clear coat. And that's the top of it over there. So mix it two parts clear coat to one part hardener to one part thinner. Excuse the voice because I'm speaking through a gas mask at the moment. I'm going to avoid breathing in the fumes. So I'm just using this top of a paint pot as a convenient way for measuring the volumes, and that's probably all I need anyhow. I'll actually stir it at the same time. Saves me having to use another mixing bowl. A little more clearing up otherwise. So if you find that the spray surface is a bit rough and uneven, a bit like orange peely, then add a bit more thinner to it. I reckon constituency is about right when it has that sort of tailing off drip, you see falling off the bottom of the screwdriver there, where it falls off with a very thin stream just before it starts dripping, if you'll see that. There we go, very thin stream, just about right for coming out of the spray gun.
So next we put it into the spray gun through the filter and just check that the spray gun is spraying out okay in a nice even pattern.
Right, that's the lacquer sprayed on. It's not a perfect finish, but it's a good enough finish. Obviously on the edge of the lacquer it'll be all rough, but that'll have to be tea cut, all very light grey, high grade sandpaper, I don't know, 1200 or 2400 grade or something, and then tea cut it and polish it as well. Similarly in the top, not perfect, and of course one of the troubles with spraying outdoors is you can get little particles and things in it, but again most of that will sand off. So here we see the Alpine window after the lacquer spray. Okay, not absolutely perfect, but certainly good enough, and hopefully after the rough edge is tea cut in, it will be good enough for a car this age. Right, after the respraying you'll get a little bit of this dull overspray in various different places. So here it's quite prominent, a little bit, you can see it there, getting the right angle. So the way to get rid of those is basically to polish them off. If it's particularly rough like this one, could use a bit of very very fine sandpaper first. This is 1200 grade sandpaper, just to start it off. You can tell when the paint is quite rough, it makes much more of a sort of shushing noise as you're moving the sandpaper over it, and after a while it actually gets less noisy, which shows that the surface is getting smoother. And then what we'll do then is you can either apply a large amount of effort, elbow grease, what they call. Or you can get one of these polishing machines, which I'm going to do in this case. It's basically just a bit like an angle grinder, but at variable speed and with various different foam pads you can get on the end of it. It's exactly the same as rubbing it by hand. Start off with a low speed. But that just takes a little bit of the effort out of it. Add a little bit of water onto the pad, stopping out drying out, stop it drying out too prematurely. Probably a few minutes worth would be enough to polish off most of it. So you take your car to a body shop, for instance, with a small knock on a small part of the wing, they'll tend to respray the whole wing. Just because you avoid the problem of trying to match in the overspray and all the sanding and polishing that's required. But if you're doing it yourself, then well, you have a choice. You can either respray the whole wing yourself or put a little bit more time and effort into trying to match it in. This colour is probably quite an easy colour to match in, being a dark colour, and especially the fact that it's got lacquer on top as well. Is the main bit of paint that you're trying to match in is lacquer, which of course is colourless, so you haven't really got any colour difference in the lacquer to worry about. And you preserve the gradual overspray effect, or gradual merging in effect of the paint underneath, because you've allowed the paint to overspray and then completely covered that in the lacquer. So you can see it's starting to get a little bit more shiny now as the rubbing compound is drying out. Yeah, actually what I haven't mentioned is what sort of compound we've got on. So I've used it Faracla, however you pronounce it, G3, which is basically a rubbing compound. They do it in various different grades. It's a fairly fine one. It's starting to get nice and shiny now underneath. But as it dries out, you get all these little dust particles start flying up over there, of course. Will require a little bit of cleaning up afterwards. So you can see it's starting to look shiny, so we'll just get a little rag and rub off the rubbing compound to see what we've got underneath. Get rid of the dust that's been flying everywhere. And now you can see how the overspray has turned into quite nice shiny paintwork. And you can't really see where the paint has been, where it hasn't, apart from the bits where I've deliberately not bothered with. And some of these edges, particularly that bit there, it's going to show and it's been a bit rough. But at some point you run out of effort to do these things. But generally that's good enough. A few scratch marks could do a polishing off at some time there. But basically, how good a surface and how good a final finish you get is up to you. But you can see this bit of overspray has now been perfectly matched in and is nice and shiny. So just down to doing the rest as much as you want to. There's a little bit in the corner there that was difficult to get the polishing wheel into, so that'll have to be done by hand. So similarly here, where we'd filled and sprayed on the top of the door around these bits, that's all been sprayed and finished. There was quite a lot of dull overspray around here that I've had a bit of a go at. Probably needs a little bit more polishing. Just a very slight, not dullness, but there's a very slight effect you can see, but yeah, maybe a little bit of dullness around there. But overall, that's starting to look quite reasonable. And certainly the colour matching is quite good, and you can see it is possible to merge in the lacquer, the new lacquer, with the old lacquer. Certainly around these bits it's pretty good, so it just shows you what sort of finish is possible. You see I fitted new rubbers as well on here, some of which are available. It's just one that's not no longer available. You could watch one of my other videos for how to renovate them. when you can't get hold of the rubber, because one of the problems with these rubbers is they have aluminium metal inserts in them to keep them straight, and water can get into the edge and corrode. This bit becomes all bubbly, starts pushing out, water then gets down the gap that then forms between the rubber and the window. But they cost about £20 new, but they're starting to go obsolete. One of them is now obsolete, as we're talking about, well, this is an 18-year-old car. But there is a way to strip out the aluminium and just re-glue it in place. So watch one of my other videos for that. But give you a quick view. That's a new rubber. That's a renovated rubber. Slight difference, slightly less straight, but all the bubbliness from the corrosion has been removed, and it's been glued in place with polymer sealant. So while refitting the Alpine window, we want to do something to improve the water seal, because obviously there's been a bit of an issue with water getting in just the standard rubber seal on its own. And the fact that these bits are rotted at the bottom is quite a common thing to go. So what we'll do is use our favourite polymer sealant again. Lots of different makes of polymer sealant, but just to look for the word polymer. Black. And this is particularly sticky, long-lasting. So what we're going to do is put a little bead around the top edge before we install the rubber, which will hopefully stop the water getting past the rubber seal. Rubber itself is quite easy to fit. You fit the rubber to the bodywork first, then slot in the glass later, just pulling the lip of the rubber over the glass. It's quite easy to fit on this particular window, because the rubber has more slack in it, because the way that slack is taken up is with a beading that goes into the centre of the rubber afterwards, which is a little laborious to fit, but just takes time rather than a lot of skill or technology. It does need a little bit of patience, however, just like doing this job. Now, this polymer sealant is very, very tacky, so you want to be careful that you don't touch it and get it over other things. As soon as you start getting it on your hands, which is very, very easy, and all of a sudden it starts spreading everywhere, because as I say, as soon as you touch it, it sticks to it, whatever the substance or surface is. Still quite a good condition, this rubber seal. Not sure whether it's been replaced at some time. Quite possibly has. So it goes that way around. Pop it in to the car. Put the bottom on first, I think. Right, work your way along, pushing that sealant down slowly. There we go. Just poke that bit of rubber into the corners. Basically, this thick piece of rubber, you obviously need to get in between the roof lining and the metalwork. Pop that rubber in the gap. Right, fit in the lower edge first.
And the refitting of the rest of the bead and the windows covered in one of my other videos, so I'm not going to linger on it here. Look out for that on my channel. The only point to note is to wipe off the sealant as it oozes out between the seal and the bodywork.
And that's the result after a bit of polishing. All fairly well merged in. Resealed Alpine window at the top, repainted around the rusty bits, resprayed, and that's the top of the doors done, resprayed, rubber renovated. I've taken out the corrosion aluminium, this one's a new one,
and fairly respectable finish on it, and quite well matched in with the car bodywork as well. Quite nice and shiny, so that's reasonably pleasing.
So thanks for watching and good luck with doing your own.